This election year, justice is on the ballot. Protesters demanding change across America and right here in our own backyard. While the focus is on our police, what about our prosecutors? From rising crime to who's getting charged and why and for how long? Two back-to-back debates from both sides of our state line. The Jackson County prosecutor takes on her opponent, and the Johnson County DA takes on his challenger in an election year like no other. It's Justice on the Ballot.
Justice on the Ballot is presented in part by the Johnson County Bar Association, 1,400 members, serving the community since 1938. And now, here's your moderator, Nick Haines.
Glad to have you with us this hour. If you're working off an old copy of our program schedule, you may be expecting to see a United States Senate debate right now, or even a Kansas 3rd Congressional District debate. But when you've been negotiating with candidates since August, and they refuse every single date you offer them between now and Election Day, well, you have to pivot. Rather than just throwing up our hands and doing nothing, we have back-to-back debates from both sides of our state line on some of the most pressing and divisive issues playing out here and across the country. If you're concerned about rising crime, about a movement to defund the police, if you've expressed alarm about the excessive use of force by officers, particularly against people of color, this hour is for you. We're lifting up the hood on one of the most influential actors in our criminal justice system, and unlike the police chief, you get to vote for them. They are our prosecutors and district attorneys, and as this new election awareness campaign from the ACLU makes clear, they have a remarkable power most voters simply overlook.
Of all the actors in criminal justice system, no actor makes more decisions or a wider array of decisions than the prosecutor. You know, the police decide, do we arrest this person or not? And judges basically face the question of how much we sentence this person convicted of to prison or not. But prosecutors have to decide, do we charge at all?
District attorney can go to a police department and say, look, I have no interest in prosecuting marijuana offenses or prosecuting name your offense. They can do that.
We don't have to wait for laws to get changed. We could change the criminal justice system tomorrow.
While there are more than 1,000 prosecutors and district attorneys on the ballot this election day, you get to vote on two of them, and they're never out of the headlines.
Violence in Kansas City is a public health epidemic.
A bombshell announcement today from the Jackson County prosecutor. Starting today, she will not prosecute marijuana possession cases.
Howe declined to bring charges against the officer responsible for killing an Overland Park teen.
He felt like he was going to get run over. And we believe that based on the evidence that we have available, that was a reasonable belief.
Jackson County prosecutors decided not to file state charges against two men accused of vandalizing this Andrew Jackson statue.
This office has reviewed all the evidence compiled and has declined to file charges against Tyreek Hill.
The suspect in court for the first time on Tuesday formally charged with killing three in a hate crime at two Jewish centers.
He's charged with capital murder, which is the most serious crime that you can be charged with in the state of Kansas.
Jackson County prosecutor Gene Peters Baker announced that Sergeant Matthew Neal is charged with third-degree assault.
The victim can be heard saying, I can't breathe. Those, I realize, are now pretty infamous words.
We'll hear from Steve Howe, the Johnson County District Attorney, along with his challenger, Zach Thomas, a little later this hour. But with us now is Gene Peters Baker, the Jackson County prosecutor, a job she has held for the past 9 years, and for the first time since being elected, is facing a general election challenger. That challenger is Tracey Chappell, the city prosecutor in Blue Springs. Ms. Chappell has managed her own law firm, worked as an investigator for the state agency that handles misconduct complaints against attorneys, and the county office responsible for civil commitments of the mentally ill. Ms. Baker, sometimes elected office is a what have you done for me lately kind of a job. What have you done for us lately that as voters we would say you deserve another 4 years in the job of prosecutor?
I think I have performed consistently, compassionately, but also with experience. You know, I have personally started as an intern in that office. I've left a couple of times, but I moved to an assistant prosecuting attorney, to a trial team leader, to the chief warrant officer, to the position that I have today. And I didn't get that in any other way, but I earned each one of those positions. I'm not from a political family, so I had to get there by earning it, clawing my way through the office to do the right thing. So that's what I do every day in this job. I've had an opportunity to try numerous cases for this office, at least over 70 cases. And the last one I tried last fall, which sadly we've not been in trial for a while, but was Deja Bowsby's murder. She was brutally murdered by her father. And it was really an excruciating case, but it was such an honor to represent Deja, her family, and people like her. I have represented hundreds of people just like her in this system. Plus, I go to crime scenes. I'm not a prosecutor who sits in my office. I get into my community. So I have been at the yellow tape repeatedly. I will continue to go. It is a very difficult job. I'll tell you, when I pull up, my stomach still flips sometimes at that yellow tape because I know what I'm going to encounter.
So given all that you've heard then, Tracey Chappell, why are you running against Jean Peters Baker?
Thank you for that question, Mr. Haines. I am running against Ms. Baker because, you know, I am not only a prosecutor for the city of Blue Springs, but I have been a criminal defense attorney for over 20 years. I have practiced extensively in Jackson County. I have had sexual assault cases. I have had first-degree assault cases, sexual assault. I've second-chaired a murder. I've had a myriad of cases that I've tried and that I've dealt with, not only in Jackson County, but also Platte County, Clay County, and surrounding counties. There was one case in particular that I had against the Jackson County Prosecutor's Office where a gentleman was charged with child abuse, and there were a lot of discrepancies in that case. I pointed them out to Ms. Baker. I sent her an email and said, look at this case, because what your prosecutor is doing is on the border, if not prosecutorial misconduct. When I sent that email, along with a letter and deposition transcripts from police officers in the Kansas City Police Department, Ms. Baker did nothing. I had to watch a gentleman who had to go to prison, who had no criminal history whatsoever. I saw a family be destroyed because of that.
And it's because of that case that you decided to run against her. What is your response to that?
I'm glad you respond. That's not the first time I heard that. So I went back and scoured my system to find that response. The problem was Ms. Chappell sent that to the wrong email address, so I didn't get it. So when you are a prosecutor, it's important that you're very right about the facts. You gotta be right. You can't just be emotional and you can't just throw out bombs at people. You have to be right. So an experienced prosecutor knows that. The other thing I'll say on that particular case, others in the office did get her emails and did respond. The thing is, the allegations that she's made on that case were heard by a judge. They were heard by a Jackson County jury. They were refuted repeatedly by the judge on that case and by the Jackson County jury. So that stepfather was convicted by a jury of abusing his stepson, and it was really awful abuse that young man suffered. He is a hero, and I'm actually proud of him.
We're talking about cases in the past, but the prosecutor's office deals with cases right now that are happening, that are right now in the news. Concerns over the excessive use of force by police is not just an issue that's playing out in protests around the country. As we stand here, dozens of tents have been pitched outside of City Hall as part of a round-the-clock protest over the actions of a Kansas City police officer seen on video kneeling on a pregnant woman during an arrest. As a prosecutor, Jean Peters Baker, how do you balance the needs of the police to maintain order while holding them accountable when their actions harm citizens?
Yeah. Look, this is a really tough issue for the community, but it is a really tough issue under the law in Missouri. So a prosecutor has to go with the law that we have rather than the law that you want. But my office has taken a really engaged approach on these cases. So while I'm at the crime scene of a lot of different types of crimes, I'm definitely at the scene when police officers engage in use of force, fatal use of force against citizens, because our involvement's got to start right then. That's what makes our homicide unit so good in Kansas City, is that I created an effort where all prosecutors have to go to the scene of every homicide. But for my engagement, and a key level of staff's engagement on these types of cases, it's important to guide those cases then through the criminal justice system. But most importantly, Nick, the police cannot investigate themselves. You just can't do it. And as a prosecutor, I don't do it. When a prosecutor is accused of alleged criminal wrongdoing, I don't oversee their prosecution. I don't charge it. I provide that case to a neighboring county to do for the office, because that's what the community expects, and that's what they deserve.
Campaigns are about differences. Would your approach be different than Jean Peters Baker's, Tracey?
I will tell you, Mr. Haines, when you are approaching situations like the one that you just described, in order to navigate through the process, you have to have the trust of the community. The current prosecutor does not have the trust of the community. Probably about a week ago, the current prosecutor and Chief Rick Smith and the current mayor actually got together to form an alliance to talk about criminal law or talk about crime in the community and what we need to do about it. They did not have the support of the ACLU, the SCLC, the NAACP.
Or the Urban League, for that matter.
Or the Urban League, for that matter, absolutely. And it is because, as Ms. Baker said in a news article with the Kansas City Star, they don't trust us.
Okay, you've said that on the steps of City Hall back in July. You did a news conference there where you said, we can't get the trust of the community is in a crisis because the community does not trust the police, and that hinders the police from solving and preventing crimes. So how are you gonna build that trust if you are the prosecutor?
Thank you. As the next Jackson County prosecutor, I understand that I have to be a bridge that connects the police department as well as the community. The community will react when you interact with them. When you bring the community along with you regarding what new policies and procedures you're going to implement on their behalf, that's when the trust begins to be built. Right now, that is not happening. Right now, what you have is individuals like the current prosecutor who says, I have a 6-point plan, or there's a 4-point plan by the mayor, or a 5-point plan, and they present it to the community. But the one thing that they did not do, they did not consult the community that they are saying we're going to serve. And when you cannot do that, you cannot garner that trust.
Not doing enough to consult with the community to help fix crime, Jean Peters Baker?
Agreed. It's true. And she got that from my own comments at the steps of City Hall. But it is a true statement that community can't just be, you just can't do neighborhood walks, you can't even do listening tours. Those are important and you should do them. But community needs to have a key stake at the table. So when we launched Casey's No Violence Alliance, the previous mayor and academics and the previous police chief and myself, we engaged community. But even then, it was a miss. It was a missed opportunity. If we had engaged community at a deeper level, I believe that effort would have been better sustained than you see it today. So the reason I stood on the steps of City Hall and said those very same words was because we can engage them. This is a great community. They want this to work. They want better police community relations. So let's bring the Urban League or SCLC, let them choose.
You've been in this job for 9 years. Why haven't you done that already?
Oh, I have done that. Personally, I have done that. Now, I can't direct the police department on what they're going to do or not do, and I can't direct the mayor on how to do that. All I can say is when we are collaborative, when I'm collaborating with the two of them and others, is that the community must have a key seat at the table, not just from a listening role, but in helping us shape and form policy for this city.
You can't solve everything. You're not in charge of everything, of course, as prosecutor, but you still have lots of power. Can you name me one thing that you have done to actually reduce violent crime in Kansas City since you were prosecutor?
Yes, I can. That effort, Casey's No Violence Alliance in 2014, was a tremendous effort. Now, we did that really with the help of a very, very broad collaboration. We brought in academics to kind of help teach us and lead the way. So we needed to trust them. And we did. And what happened is in 2014, we had the lowest homicide rate in 50 years. Beyond the lowest homicide rate, the clearance rate for homicide also shot way up. So we were way above the national average for the police in solving those cases. So there's an inverse relationship on those two things. It is a wonderful thing when it happens. The goal for us is how do we get that back and sustain that over a period of time.
What one change would you make? What one program would you implement as prosecutor that would help reduce violent crime in Kansas City, Tracey?
Thank you, Mr. Haines. I would like to have one individual representative from every neighborhood association to join me on a quarterly basis to discuss what is going on in your neighborhood and be able to tell them what services we are able to offer them as it relates to violent crime. Because I understand, as being a prosecutor who is the bridge builder in this community, you have to let the people know that you believe in them, that they can trust you, and that you are going to prosecute crime to the fullest extent of the law. And what you say you're gonna do, you're gonna actually do. When you can do those things and you bring the community along, Mr. Haines, I am telling you, the community will follow you wherever you go.
Ms. Peters-Baker, you have chosen not to prosecute those arrested for vandalizing a statue of Andrew Jackson outside the downtown courthouse. You decided not to prosecute marijuana possession cases. As you ask for another four-year term, what other crimes are you considering not prosecuting?
It's a good question. But let me back up to the vandalism of the statutes. That's a city prosecutor's realm. Vandalism has not been handled at the state level before, so we simply referred that case back to its appropriate place, the city prosecutor. I think there are other areas that we need to look at and that I am actively looking at right now. And that is through a racial equity lens, I'm looking at the cases that come in through the door of the prosecutor's office. So not only bonds, should we look at bonds and look at racial disparities in that category, but we need to back up. And what comes through my door? And when it comes through my door, how did it get here? What was the strategy behind police in getting that case to me? And then I'm taking a hard look at this, and I'm going to see what we might be able to do to pare some of those cases back out of the office or push them to a more appropriate place, like perhaps the city prosecutor's office.
Would you have chosen not to prosecute simple marijuana possession cases? Would you have chosen not to prosecute vandals at the statue of Andrew Jackson at the downtown courthouse, Ms. Chappell?
Yes, Mr. Haines. When I look at the issue of the statue of Andrew Jackson, I understand that that is a property crime. And if it's over the amount of $750, it's a felony and it needs to be prosecuted. I also understood at that time when it was defaced and the decision was made not to prosecute, not at the city level, but when it's a felony, it is at a state level. When it wasn't prosecuted, I said, it's gonna happen again. It's like dealing with my four boys. If I don't correct them up front, they're gonna continue pushing the envelope. And that is exactly what happened in this case. After the Andrew Jackson statute was defaced, nothing was done. Thereafter, probably about less than a month later, you had the memorial at the Kansas City Police Department that was also defaced. That is because there is nothing done. There were no repercussions for the original defacement. And when you don't have the repercussions, the behavior continues on and on. So it absolutely should have been.
Is that true also then of marijuana possession? The police chief, for instance, says that could be a gateway drug to far more serious offenses that take place in Kansas City. So would you also prosecute those?
I would.
In Boston, the district attorney has a decline to prosecute list of 15 charges, including receiving stolen property and shoplifting. Would you decline to prosecute those?
Again, the way our city is structured is different than Boston. There are municipal prosecutors like Ms. Chappell who handle shoplifting. And then at the state level, it is much more serious crimes, murder, rape, domestic violence, drive-by shootings. And there are others, robberies that are important to us. Property crimes is also a very hard issue and one that we do lean into those prosecutions at the state level in half. But we're not like other jurisdictions, so I'm not looking to take city-level cases and bring them up to the state. In fact, I would do the opposite. There have been city-level cases that rise up to the state level, like driving while your license is suspended or revoked. I think those need to go back to a city prosecutor to handle, because I believe it's more of a poor man's ticket rather than something that can be solved at the state level.
Are there any charges or any crimes that you would not prosecute? Tracey Chappell.
You know, I think maybe the simple, like I would agree with Ms. Baker, the DWIs, or I'm sorry, the driving while suspended or revokes, those I would not prosecute at a state level. I would not.
A new study claims Missouri puts more children in adult jails than most any other state in the nation. And in Jackson County, Ms. Peters-Baker, 95% of youths, they say, charged as adults are children of color. How do you account for that?
Those are children who have been certified to stand trial as an adult for murder, and those are murder cases. So I can think of a handful of those that have been charged over the past 4 or 5 years, and Nick, they're murder cases.
Your response to that, Tracey Chappell?
Even though they're murder cases, there's a disproportionate number of individual juveniles who are charged more on or certified on an adult basis than their other counterparts. Right now, we are 12th, I think, in the nation of having juveniles in the Jackson or in the detention centers with adults, and these are minorities. We have to look at these cases. We have to do better to increase what we're doing with our minorities.
Okay. We also know, for instance, on drug cases, studies show that black people and white people use illegal drugs at similar rates, but black right. people are in prison for drug crimes almost six times more often. What role do you play, if any, in altering that disparity, Ms. Baker?
Yes, that is a great question. So, you know, Jackson County was one of the first counties in the nation to start a drug court. That was 30 years ago. It's amazing how that was very controversial at the time. What I have done is continue to expand the eligibility requirements or lower those in appropriate manner so that more people can afford themselves of that kind of treatment. However, that does not explain all those cases that come to the door of the prosecutor. That's what I talked about earlier, is that we must look at those through a racial equity lens. When white people and black people and brown people use drugs really within the same, we have the same usage, then why is it? Why is it that we are choosing to enforce in areas where more minorities live? And that is an issue that I am taking on right now. We have a crime analyst that I hired last fall, and we are digging into the referrals that come to my office, not just what we file, but before we file. How did it get here? And what can we do to address this through a racial equity lens?
How would your approach be different, if at all, Tracey Chappell?
I tell you, Mr. Haines, you have to have statistics that are kept in the prosecutor's office. And you must keep those statistics involving the race of the individual, the age, the gender of those individuals to make sure that you are not prosecuting in a manner that's not even-handed. Right now, as a defense attorney, I am seeing cases where you may have more people of color who are prosecuted at a higher level than their counterparts. This certainly can be stopped or viewed. You can view it more accurately if you actually keep the statistics of those individual defendants that are seen in your that come before you.
On your website, you say you will use the prosecutor's power to end mass incarceration. Name me one thing you would do as prosecutor to do that.
Absolutely. I am definitely, as your next prosecutor, I am going to bring back preliminary hearings. It has been said to me that, oh, Tracey, we brought back preliminary hearings 2 or 3 years ago. I was utterly shocked because as a defense attorney, I have repeatedly asked for a preliminary hearing and I have been denied by assistant prosecutors who say to the judge, no, judge, we're asking for a continuance so that we can send this case to the grand jury to be indicted. What a preliminary hearing is going to do, it's going to give the defendant early and often the ability to know what evidence is against them and allow us to present that evidence before the court and allow the judge right then and there to say, hey, there is enough probable cause to move this case forward to a trial division. Therefore, that defendant is not sitting in jail and it's more likely than not, it's the individual who cannot post bond, who would have to sit there for 6 months or a year or 2 years waiting for their trial. When you have something up front, like a preliminary hearing, you know up front what is before you as a defendant, and either you can work out something and be out or, you know, whatever the, if it has to go to jail, then you're doing that too. But you know up front, early and often, what's going to happen.
Your opponent mentions people not being able to pay a bond. There is a movement across the country to eliminate a cash bail for jailed suspects awaiting trial. It's argued poor people stay indefinitely confined while those with money get to wait for their trials at home. As prosecutor, would you eliminate cash bail? And if so, what would you replace it with?
We have eliminated cash bail for low-level offenses. So that is a truth that's been in place for some time. Regarding preliminary hearings, we did start those back. I did in 2011, by the way. But not all prelims are the same. Domestic violence victims should not have to go in front of their abuser when they are in trauma and when they are in danger. So that's why we use a grand jury. Same on child sex cases or child abuse cases, where a child has to face their accuser. So there are reasons that can't be used at all times.
You mentioned keeping people out of prison and ending mass incarceration or reducing mass incarceration. One issue that comes up for doing that is diversion programs.
Yes.
How do you ensure diversion programs, though, are being offered to everyone regardless of a defendant's ability to pay? When we hear from the New York Times, some of these diversion programs can cost somebody with a low-level marijuana possession charge up to $5,000 in all of the fees.
Absolutely. I will tell you now, Mr. Haines, like I said before, I'm the prosecutor in the city of Blue Springs. When I came into Blue Springs, there was no diversion programs whatsoever. I saw minors, or actually people who had been in high school, who had possession charges or who had assault charges against them. When I saw that, I understood the repercussions of an individual starting their life out with a record. And so I started a diversion program in the city of Blue Springs where there was none. And we kept the cost low because more likely than not, we would offer a lot of community service, things like that. We would offer certain classes that they could take depending on what the nature of the crime was. So we worked to keep it cost effective, but at the same time, it was a great tool to give a second chance for those individuals starting out in life. Because when you start off with an assault on your record, or a possession on your record, or whatever on your record, that follows you wherever you go. And it taunts your ability to have, adequate employment.
I know that you do have diversion programs, and that
yes,
has been
and
important
they're free.
To you.
And they're
but
free.
But even for, so regardless of ability to pay, you can be part of a diversion program?
You bet. New Start Diversion is a program I started in 2015. I did a pilot project just to try and build up for that program first to kind of see what would work. And fees are a killer. And so I wanted New Start Diversion to be free so that it wouldn't be a barrier for someone that needs to go through, get some conditions, and get through the criminal justice system safely without a conviction.
State lawmakers oftentimes blame people just like you, though you used
yes.
to be a state lawmaker yourself, for being too loose with regards to prosecuting crimes to the full extent of the law. Too many plea bargains. And that also has a chilling effect, they say, on police officers willing to go out and make arrests when they don't feel they have the back from a prosecutor. How do you respond to those accusations?
They should learn more about our system. Because I put in place a really robust homicide analysis. So not only do we go to the scene to work cases, but every homicide case that the police can solve comes into this setting where a committee vets the case. Our goal is to file the case. Now, filing the case is one step, right? It's a great one because it's an opportunity for justice for a family who's been waiting. But plea bargains come along after a lot of time and energy has been put into that case. And it is a little bit, you give a little bit and you gain a little bit. One of the things you gain and the family gains is they know the outcome, right? And so it's really good for some homicide victims' families to be able to take them through and tell them appeals are gonna end with this deal. And we get their agreement is if that is something that they want to engage in.
Tracey Chappell, your response to that question.
Absolutely. Mr. Haines, I have talked to a myriad of officers, and I want people to know that even though we are in one Jackson County, it's almost like two different counties in one. We have the Kansas City proper that we're dealing with, where we're dealing with the violent crime and the homicides. And then we're also dealing in Eastern Jackson County with the property crimes. When I tell you that I am getting calls, and I'm not even the prosecutor yet, from a myriad of police officers in Eastern Jackson County complaining about the lack of prosecution of property crimes. When they get calls for burglaries, calls for car thefts, and other, other thefts, they work those cases up. They are doing all the investigation and doing everything that they can. When they present those to the prosecutor's office, those cases are what we call yellow sheeted, meaning they are denied prosecution. That leaves the police officers discouraged because they are working these cases and they're going nowhere. It's almost like the bridge to nowhere. They're presenting them for prosecution and they're not being prosecuted. So not only are the police officers disgruntled, but the victims themselves are disgruntled. And let me tell you this, the victims are victimized twice over because when the cases are not prosecuted in the manner that they should, then the victim has to go to their insurance company. Well, you know, if you get enough of those calls to your insurance company, now that area is labeled as a crime-ridden area and the rates shoot up. So you have, when you're dealing with the whole spectrum of the police officers and how they prosecute these cases, you know, I look and say, I told one police officer today, I said, he says, well, Tracey, where do we start? I said, you have to start by doing your job of prosecuting. And that is not only the violent crimes in Kansas City, but you also have to prosecute those property crimes that are out of control in Eastern Jackson County.
I run into you at the grocery store. I am a voter and I see you in the cereal aisle and I ask you in 20 seconds or less, why on earth should we vote for you for prosecutor? Your answer would be?
Because I have a willingness to prosecute all crime even-handedly across the board. I have a willingness to bridge the gap between the community and the police departments so that we are not in dire straits like we are today. It is my job to be the keeper of justice, not for just one side of the county, but for the entire county.
And I've moved into the coffee and tea aisle of the grocery store where I see Jean Peters Baker and I say, I'm a voter too. Why should you have another 4 years in 20 seconds or less?
You know it was coffee, it wasn't tea.
Okay.
Okay. I serve with this notion that you can't be a victim and a leader. I am a leader. And I've demonstrated that throughout the years in my term in this office by filing a case against a seated bishop for crimes against kids, but also not filing cases against a Republican governor for his bad acts. I am not afraid to make hard decisions. I am not afraid to lead. I'm not afraid to take critique. That is how the system improves, and that's why I'm here for another 4 years.
The two candidates appearing on your ballot for Jackson County Prosecutor, Jean Peters Baker and Tracey Chappell, thank you so much. Up next, we move to the other side of our state line, where Johnson County District Attorney Steve Howe is facing his first opponent since being elected the county's top attorney 12 years ago. You're watching Justice on the Ballot. If you live in Johnson County, you'll know that pretty much every available patch of green space along its streets have now been taken up by campaign signs. Among them are these signs for the candidates wanting to be your Johnson County District Attorney. They are made of cardboard, but the people behind those signs are not. They are real living and breathing human beings. They're not even on Zoom screen. They are here in our studio. With us is Steve Howe, who has been the District Attorney in Johnson County for the past 12 years. In fact, this is the first time he's drawn an opponent since he was first elected to the office. That opponent is trial lawyer Zach Thomas, a former Johnson County public defender who's now in private practice in Olathe. Steve Howe, if I'm a voter in Johnson County and I'm thinking, why do you deserve another 4 years in this job? What have you done for me thus far?
Well, that's a really good question, and thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning. You know, we've done an excellent job over the last 12 years of keeping Johnson County safe. And I had the passion to be the prosecutor for not only the next 4 years, but beyond. And that is because I take something that my father told me when I was in college. He says, pick a career that you have a passion for and a desire to go to work. And if you do that, it'll reward you. And I became a prosecutor in 1988. And immediately I realized this was my niche in life, that the passion to provide justice for victims and keep the community safe was something that really drove me and made me passionate. 30 years later, I'm standing before you as the district attorney of Johnson County. And so people may ask, do you still have that passion? And how do you have that passion after 30 years of being a prosecutor? And I will tell you, I'll give you a couple stories why I still have that passion. Number one, many Mondays I'll walk into my front lobby of my office and I'll see domestic violence victims battered and bruised, looking for opportunities to get protection orders. That gives me the passion to continue and to serve. Also, we see situations where we have victims, families who have lost their loved ones because of violence, or a sexual assault victim who's looking for peace and justice for what has been done to her. Those are the things that drive me to continue to want to be your district attorney, to serve those victims and the community.
So how would you be any different? What would you bring to the table, Zach Thomas, that we're not currently seeing from the current district attorney in Johnson County?
Fresh eyes, fresh energy, perspective. Steve talks about passion. I have that passion. I have that very passion, but I have a different sense of how the office should be run, how it could be run better. I don't doubt Steve's qualities, but the facts speak for themselves. Over the past 4-8 years, performance in that office has dwindled. I'm a lawyer. I'm a trial lawyer. I'm a successful trial lawyer. I'll be in the courtroom. I'm not going to be sitting in an office. We talk about DV victims serving as passion. I represent, I'm in the courtroom with them. And I see how interns are the ones handling their cases. That's a travesty. If your first foray into the courtroom experience is as a domestic violence victim, and your case is handled by an intern, that's problematic. There's a litany of changes I would bring to the office.
On your website, you say under the current district attorney, violent crime has increased 50% in Johnson County. How would, you're not running, by the way, for sheriff, or you're not running for police chief. How would violent crime go down if you were the district attorney?
Criminals would know that I'm going to hold them accountable. Trial percentages, the own effectiveness measures put out by the district attorney in the budget, show that their effectiveness measures have precipitously dropped from 85% when Steve Howe was first elected to 69% in 2017 to 53%. That means 47% of the defendants that went to trial walked away scot-free. He'll talk about how general crime has gone down 29%, but that's gone down 29% all across the country. In Johnson County alone, violent crime has drastically increased. You need somebody who's going to hold these individuals accountable. You need somebody who's going to step into the courtroom and hold them accountable personally.
Okay, on your opponent's website, Mr. Howe, he says public areas such as Oak Park Mall have seen a startling rise in violent crimes. Murders are becoming routine in Johnson County. On your watch, name one thing you have done to reduce violent crime in Johnson County since you were elected district attorney.
Number one, we hold them accountable. Since I've been district attorney, we've had 103 murder and attempted murder cases brought to the conclusion. 100 of those 103 resulted in conviction. That's a 97% conviction rate. And in regards to my office and dealing with violent crime and dealing with major issues, over a 12-year period, our conviction rate in jury trial is 74%. And we convict about 80% of the people that we go before the district court. And you know, the other thing is, I don't cherry pick. One of the things I tell my staff is try the right cases. And if you want a politician who's cherry picking, who wants stats, then I'm not your man. If you want a prosecutor who wants to do the right thing and hold offenders accountable, then I'm your prosecutor. And so we try cases that most prosecutors' offices wouldn't even try to try. But we'll take those tough cases, and sometimes we lose. But you know, that's okay because we're trying to do the right thing versus the easy way out.
Now, we originally planned to do this program in front of a large audience in Johnson County. A worldwide pandemic halted that. But as part of our partnership with the Johnson County Bar Association, we still wanted you to respond to questions from the people who will be voting for you. Are you ready? Well, first up is John.
Recently, there's been a significant national push for the reform and accountability of the police for in response to its use of deadly force against black people and other racial minorities. Under your leadership, how would our DA's office work to keep our police accountable for its use of force while also maintaining a productive relationship with the police to ensure that our laws are enforced and that our communities are kept safe?
How do you answer that question, Zach Thomas?
Accountability starts with me as your district attorney. I'm going to hold myself accountable to go out there and see what happened, what transpired. Mistakes do happen on the job. We've got to hold those individuals accountable. But when something doesn't happen, when an officer makes a decision in a split second, there's a lifetime for review and criticism. as district attorney, you've got to make a statement. You've got to answer questions that directly and clearly and concisely resolve the issue. You've got to be transparent and say why you made this decision and how you reached it. Making a statement that has holes in it, that causes a question of credibility in the public, well, that causes problems like we have right now with the FBI investigation.
We're talking about a case because it's not just things that are happening right now. You actually had to handle this very situation, Mr. Howe. It's something you've dealt with 2 years ago. Overland Park police respond to the home of a teenager threatening to kill himself. He is fatally shot 13 times as he tries to leave the home in the family's minivan. You decide not to file charges against the officer, saying his actions were justified. The officer had feared for his life. Now, 2 years later, we're in a very different place in America. If you were presented with the same information today, would you have made any changes to the way you responded to that case?
Well, I would say no, and let me explain why. First of all, the law hasn't changed. The facts haven't changed. And our process, if you look at what we did in that case, is we made a decision. I did a written decision that I released to the public. I sat in a press conference and answered every question that the media wanted. I also played a video that basically depicted the primary events that led to our decision, two different videos. But before that, I met with the family. And I do this every time I have an officer-involved shooting. I sit down with the family and try to answer their questions. They may not agree with my decision, but I'm going to give them an opportunity to ask the questions and be transparent with them. And really, the issue is not about transparency. It's about, do people agree with your decision? And that's really what it's all about. As far as transparency, we provided all the information and the reasons why we made that decision. And I do that each and every time. And so at some point in time, people have to understand that I have to make tough decisions. And I don't expect everybody to agree with them. But my decisions are based on the evidence and the law. And my duty is to follow the law, even if it's not a popular decision.
Would you have responded the same way, Zach Thomas?
No. And making a statement, first off, I would have met with the family and spoken to them, shown them common human decency. He met with the family once, right before a press conference. And it's not just an Albert situation. There's a number of victims that have echoed this during my campaign. And when I make a statement, I'm going to release a statement. I'm going to make a public statement that holds water. He mentions a video that was released. With your own very eyes, when you compare the fact sheet released by the district attorney's office with the video you watch yourself, questions arise. And when questions arise, there's a distrust. And when there's a distrust, the relationship between law enforcement and the public, the relationship between public officials and the public is eroded. So I would have made sure my statement was concise, clear, and held water.
Your response to that, Mr. Howe?
We set forth a very specific set of facts that fit the evidence in this case. And we can play with semantics, but the bottom line is playing the video and explaining the application of the evidence and the law was done in that case. And again, I made myself available to answer questions by the media. I made myself available to answer questions from the family. I'm not sure what else I can do other than release all the data and all the investigation, which has lots of traps to it. And so, as far as transparency, the other thing that I think was really important is we have an independent investigative shoot team that investigates these cases. And they've been doing that since 2005. So if you think about it, Johnson County has been way ahead of the game in making sure you have an independent investigation and not departments investigating their own.
There has been, in this push to hold police accountable, a concern among police officers and others, Zach Thomas. That'll just have a chilling effect, though, on the willingness of police officers to make arrests and to hold people accountable and to keep order. What is your response to that?
The first issue we have here, if we're talking, referencing back to the Albers case and cases with mental health issue, is we're leaving our law enforcement out to dry. For too long, they've been the sole responder. My opponent has had opportunities to bring in mental health court to address the problem early on, to stop it from escalating to a point where law enforcement is in a no-win situation. We need to address that issue head on. It's been too long. It's been used all over the country. It's a bipartisan approach. Here in Kansas alone, 13 other courts use it. Jerry Moran, Roger Marshall, they went out and got it for Ellis County. We need to tackle the problem and give our law enforcement support so they're not put in a precarious position.
Holding police out to dry, your opponent says, Mr. Howe?
Well, first of all, great story, not accurate. Johnson County is considered an innovator county nationally because of our work with mental health and mentally ill people in the criminal justice system. We were one of the first counties in the entire country to have a co-responder program where mental health workers are embedded into police departments. We also have a mental health screening by the jail, and if a person scores high enough, a mental health worker in the jail meets with that individual. I also got an agreement with the Johnson County Mental Health Department that if an individual scores as a persistent and severe mentally ill, that they will actually supervise that individual on a diversion plan. That type of cohesive effort is the reason why we are considered leaders in the country. We're not falling behind, but actually we're doing the things that other places in the country are looking to. And we're going to continue to work on that. And, you know, one of the things I do as a leader is I'm not satisfied with the status quo. And with our other leaders in our Criminal Justice Advisory Council, we continue to work towards building a better Johnson County that's safe for everybody.
Let's go back to some questions from voters. Next, we hear from Danielle.
Hello, my name is Danielle Atchison. I'm a business immigration attorney in Overland Park, Kansas. My question for you is whether or not you support the legalization of marijuana, and why or why not?
Why or why not? Do you support the decriminalization of marijuana, Zach Thomas?
As district attorney, legalization of marijuana isn't within my purview. What is the prosecution and how we handle those cases. And when you look around the counties that surround us, they handle it far less drastically than we do here in Johnson County. So the prosecution of those cases will remain. Unfortunately, over the past few years, as I mentioned, violent crime has increased. A lot of that crime centers around juveniles being shot and killed over drug deals. Legalizing the marijuana opens the door to that increase to continue.
Your response to that question, Mr. Howe?
Well, we agree for once on that topic that legalizing that drug will not solve the problem. And a lot of the what we call drug rips are occurring. And most of the shootings involving drug dealers and people who are trying to buy the drugs are not dealing with fentanyl or heroin. It's marijuana and THC cartridges. And many of them are 16 to 20 years old. And it's a serious problem, and legalizing that drug will not solve that problem. If you go look at Colorado, they legalized it and their violent crime went up. And so that's not the solution. What the solution is to try to get services for those individuals. And that's why we have a residential center and a therapeutic community to provide assistance to those who are struggling with drugs. I think there's a real delineation between drug dealers and people who have a drug habit. And we need to provide assistance and break that habit and get those people back on their feet that have that addiction versus the drug dealers who are really peddling death and causing problems in our community.
Okay, your counterpart on the other side of our state line, who we just heard from, Jackson County Prosecutor Jean Peters-Baker, takes a very different view. She is someone who has said, I'm not going to prosecute anyone for simple marijuana possession cases. She also, by the way, chose not to prosecute those arrested for vandalizing a statue of Andrew Jackson outside the downtown courthouse. As you ask for another four-year term, Mr. Howe, are there some crimes you would agree to stop prosecuting?
No. And I will tell you, it's important that the rule of law stays in place. And what I mean by that is we have laws. And I took an oath of office to uphold the Constitution of the United States and the state of Kansas. That includes the right to protest. That includes to do all the things and the civil liberties that we have. But when you start impacting on other people's liberties, then that's where you cross the line. And so as far as protesters who go across the line and start infringing on other people's rights, then they're held accountable. But, you know, in regards to simple crimes that we don't do anything, that's a slippery slope. So what's a minor crime? I've asked Mr. Thomas that because he says that we spend too much time on minor crime. What is a minor crime? I mean, as far as Oak Park Mall, we prosecute people who commit thefts and identity theft at Oak Park Mall. And the reason why is that is the economic engine for Overland Park. If we don't support the business community, then the success that we've had goes downhill.
Mr. Thomas, are there some crimes you wouldn't prosecute if you were chosen by voters in November to be the district attorney?
The only crimes I wouldn't prosecute are crimes that did not have probable cause to arrest the defendant. If you're violating the laws of Johnson County, if you're violating the laws of Kansas, you will be prosecuted. I think it's funny that Mr. Howe talks about when dealing with minor drug possession that we need to have services for individuals. He references the therapeutic community and the residential center. Well, neither of those are applicable to minor crimes. The therapeutic community requires at least a year-long worth of probation. It requires you being incarcerated. Same with the residential center. That's the very reason I'm pushing for a drug court, so we can actually address these minor crime issues. We can give them services so the individuals don't continue to commit more crimes in the future. Here in Johnson County, you mentioned Ms. Peters Baker. If you get caught with weed and you're prosecuted by Johnson County, first off, you're posting a bond. Secondly, you're gonna be on some sort of pretrial service that costs money. Then you're gonna have to be on probation for a year, and that incurs costs when everyone else is fine and release. That's not just. It's unjust to those who can't afford it.
Well, you have mentioned you want to bring a fresh set of eyes to the job of district attorney. There are new district attorneys around the country who have a very different approach to prosecution and what crimes are to be prosecuted. For instance, in Boston, the district attorney there now has a 15-charge list of decline to prosecute charges. For instance, that includes receiving stolen property and shoplifting. Would you decline to prosecute those?
That's asking for a case-by-case fact pattern. You can't say universally, no, I'm not going to prosecute that. If somebody's shoplifting, they're violating the laws of Johnson County. If somebody knowingly accepts stolen property, they're breaking the laws of Kansas. They are going to be prosecuted.
Would you choose to prosecute someone, Mr. Howe, who breaks the county mask mandate, or a business owner who violates capacity limits in their restaurant, bar, or retail store?
Well, first of all, the legislature changed that, and so there's no way to prosecute that case.
Can't it still be a civil
case? It can be a civil infraction.
With a $2,500 fine?
And I have been very open about my approach on that, and that is education, education, education. I'm not here to be in the mask
police. Can't that be the same with shoplifting or some other charges or marijuana possession? Can that be education too?
You know what? There are pretrial diversion opportunities. Like, let me give you an example. In juvenile court, over 50% of our cases get some form of diversion for those types of very cases that you're talking about. So they don't have a court case that's actually on their record, and we give them opportunities to change their ways. And so there are opportunities, but as far as not prosecuting them, absolutely not. I will not do that approach.
How about you, Zach Thomas?
Education, education, education.
How about our mask mandates? Would you prosecute something
I would
like
hold
that?
People accountable. I'm not going to tailor my needs to a business because they donate 10 times to give me a max donation. Mr. Howe talks about diversion. In 2009, oh, sorry.
Please.
In 2009, when he took office, diversion was used 17% of the time to close out cases. In 2018, it was used 7 to 8% of the time. That's 10% more prosecution that our assistant district attorneys have to have. That's not being forgiving. That's not education. And when they mess up once, that diversion's revoked.
Does everybody get the same opportunity, though, with diversion? I was looking at the New York Times talking about looking at all across the country. These are now costing, even for a marijuana possession charge, time you put in counseling, classes, non-refundable application fees. This could cost about $5,000. How do you ensure these programs are being offered to everyone, regardless of a defendant's ability to pay, Mr. Howe?
And actually, in the juvenile justice system, they reduced the cost, so it wouldn't be a factor in whether or not somebody applies for diversion. And Mr. Thomas should know as a defense attorney that I can't force somebody to take diversion. That's their constitutional right, and so I don't have the ability to force them to do it. And what's interesting is I've actually loosened the parameters for our diversion to be more encompassing to different types of crimes. And so those are the facts, but I can't force people to do it. And it's unfortunate that more people don't take the opportunity to do it. We now hand out paperwork, or we did before COVID, hand out paperwork in court to let people know about our diversion policy, because it's a perfect opportunity to do that. But the other thing that we do that no one talks about is we do hundreds of expungements a year. And so when people do get their life turned back around, do become productive members of society, we willfully execute expungements to get people back on the streets so they don't have that record on them.
Did you want to respond to that?
I did, Nick, thank you. I don't know, Mr. Howe says he's loosened the parameters of diversion. Either he doesn't know what's going on or his staff is not following his direction. 17% in 2009, 8% in 2018. You mess up even once by missing a UA, that diversion is revoked. Those are facts. He's put them out as an effectiveness measure on the Johnson County budget. He talks about expungements. You know what that requires? A conviction first. He says when they turn their life around, Well, if they got diversion like they would have in 2009, maybe they didn't have to turn their life around because they wouldn't have lost their job.
Okay, more questions now from the people who would have been in the audience if we were holding this debate in a big public venue in Johnson County, which was our plan in the beginning. Next, we hear from Tracey.
Hello, I'm Tracey DeMaria. I'm the executive director of the Johnson County Bar Association and a resident of Overland Park. And my question, how will you ensure that your personal beliefs, so religious, political, will not impact on you objectively serving in the role as our district attorney?
Steve Howe, I find this an interesting question because this is a partisan position. You run as a Republican, Mr. Thomas, you run as a Democrat. How does that label influence the way you choose to adopt policies and work in that office?
It has no bearing whatsoever. And it's just like the people I hire. I have Democrats and Republicans that work in my office. And my duty is to the Constitution and to the laws of the state of Kansas and to enforce them fairly. And so politics does not play a role. And that's a real big theme in my campaign is it's about public safety, not politics.
Does a D next to your name influence the way you look at that office, Mr. Thomas?
Not at all.
So why run as a Democrat for this office?
It's a partisan race. I've been saying the entire time this shouldn't be a partisan race. It should be about who's going to best lead, who's going to be best held accountable. You know, we talk about policies in the office and how the politics involve them. Well, in 2008, you had Steve Howe and Phil Klein out here. And they talked about Planned Parenthood and litigation going on there. Steve said he wouldn't do it. What happened in 2012, 2013? Planned Parenthood litigation. Politics does have a role in Steve Howe's office. It will not have a role in mine.
I am a voter and I just bump into you, though with a social distance, in the cereal aisle of the local grocery store. And I ask you in 20 seconds or less, why should I pick you as the Johnson County District Attorney? Your answer would be what?
Because I'm a trial lawyer. I'm a successful trial lawyer. I'm not scared of the courtroom. I've dealt with hundreds of prosecutors over my time. I've seen what works and what doesn't work. I'm bringing that perspective to Johnson County. There's a reason. Steve and I are both criminal lawyers. He's going to cite that I don't have prosecutor experience. Every case I take, I analyze from the prosecutor's perspective. It's a trial lawyer. It's a lawyer that's not scared of the courtroom. That's me.
And I'm now heading into the tea and coffee aisle, and I bump into Steve Howe, and I'm a voter, and I say, what in 20 seconds or less, why on earth should I give you another 4 years that you haven't done in 12?
Experience and success. Over the last 12 years to keep Johnson County safe. And there is a difference between a criminal defense attorney who I respect and a prosecutor. And the fact that Mr. Thomas has no idea what it requires as far as the experience, the leadership, and the ability to lead the entire criminal justice agencies forward to keep people safe.
I have to stop you there because right now on PBS, we are heading to Salt Lake City for the vice presidential debate. If you're watching us on Facebook or on our YouTube channel, stick around. I have lots more questions for these two men, and they've agreed to stay with us to provide lots more answers. By the way, you'll find our Facebook and YouTube pages under the name Kansas City PBS. You've been watching the two candidates appearing on your ballot for Johnson County District Attorney, Steve Howe and Zach Thomas. And this is Justice on the Ballot from all of us here at Kansas City PBS and from our partners with the Johnson County Bar Association. I'm Nick Haines. Keep calm and carry on.